Welcome to Pixeltunes Radio,
a podcast where we have fun talking about
video games
and video game music.
I'm Mike.
And I'm Ed.
And I'm Todd.
Wait, what?
Wait, who invited this guy over
here? I'm officially a host now, right?
For now.
You may as well be.
For now. You're the
Quest Party member, basically.
Yes, yes. you're casting cure on everybody right now, particularly Ed.
Wait, right.
Because I won the episode 50's choice selection People's Choice Award, thank you very much for that. I decided, instead of hogging it and just basically playing a bunch of Natsume and Iku Mizutani songs instead, I would save that for later and just pick something that you all would really, really love. And I know you guys have been asking for this for a really long time, so here we go. The music of Final Fantasy. Yes, we are finally tackling a bunch of Final Fantasy music. It's not a series overview. We are going chronologically, but it's not like what we've done in the past where we're like, let's play pretty much like every game, because obviously
there's way too much music.
There's way too much. So what we're doing instead is we're picking some of our favorite tracks from the Final Fantasy music universe selections, what have you. And the tracks are really varied. We want to give you a ton of variety. We didn't just want to make it, you know, all orchestral, because Ed would kill himself. I don't know.
Yes. You would have to bring so many Phoenix Downs, it wouldn't even be funny.
So, and we brought Todd along because I haven't played all these Final Fantasy games, and Ed definitely hasn't played all these Final Fantasy games.
Few, but not all.
Yes. So we wanted to bring in a bit of an expert. Are you an expert?
I have played them all. I have not finished them all, but
that's
I have played them all.
So we're going to start off in just a minute, but I believe there was a clarification corner that you wanted to mention, right?
Yes. Last episode, right, I mentioned that you could bring Eris back from the dead.
Mm-hmm.
And that was by putting green materia up your anus.
Yep.
Doesn't actually work. I tried.
Really?
Sorry about that.
Now, did you do that just for your digestive issues as well, or?
Well, I had to, you know, carve it down into a suppository shape.
Okay. Okay.
And you know, I ended up pooping radioactive green material for about a week.
Okay. Yeah. Well, see, that's the problem: is you carved it down. You have to do the whole thing in order to get Eris to come back.
So it requires stretching, is what you're saying.
Yes.
Yes. I'll try that next
time. Yeah. Yeah. Just make sure you use a lot of chocobo lube.
Yeah. God.
Oh my god. All right.
How many elixirs?
So Final Fantasy, I've always wanted to play more of the games, but I've only played a choice few, if you will. So Final Fantasy VII was my first Final Fantasy game, actually. So what about you?
Final Fantasy I.
Really?
The US Final Fantasy I.
Okay.
Believe it or not, back in the day, I was really into Final Fantasy.
Were you really?
I played them all up to 7 and beat them all up to 7. Even Mystic Quest.
Okay.
And then after 7, I tried 8. I just could not get into it. And then I just fell off the series completely.
Oh.
Except for one or two that we'll talk about as we go through the show.
Definitely.
So nowadays with the more modern Final Fantasies, I'm not up on them at all.
We'll definitely talk about Final Fantasy 8.
I've been playing Final Fantasy since NES. I played Final Fantasy 1.
Mm-hmm.
I played Final Fantasy 2 US and 3 US on Super Nintendo. I was at Toys R Us on release day to pick them up. Huge Final Fantasy fan like Ed up until 7. And being a good Nintendo fanboy, I resisted buying a PlayStation for a long time. So I didn't play 7 or 8 mm-hmm. until long after their release.
But that's funny. That's funny. Cause
I did end up going back and playing them.
Right. That's funny because I started with 7, got hyped for 8, which I'll talk about later, and then I went back and started playing some of the older games, like 5 and 6 and, 3 in the US, and that's part of the whole problem with the series is, chronologically, it's been kind of a nightmare for a lot of fans.
I think for the sake of the listeners up front, we should probably say that we're going to stick with the Japanese
numbers. Right, right.
Just because people always get confused when we say Final Fantasy II. Is it like, you know,
is
3
it
in Japan or 1 here or whatever?
Yeah.
So, you know, we should
4
probably,
that's 4, not 3.
Or whatever, you know? And 3 is 6 and 7 is whatever. Or 7 is 7.
That was an instant clarification.
Correct. I was clarified.
And there was no lube, chocobo lube involved. So we'll get started with our first game. Now we're actually going to be going chronologically, and we're starting with one that's actually pretty late in the series. So Todd's pick was Final Fantasy IV, which is, of course, 2 in America, but again, we're sticking with the Japanese numbers. And this is a track that came out in this game. July of 1991 was the release of this title. The game is for the Super NES, and the song is Fight One by the always amazing Nobuo Uematsu. Welcome back. That was Final Fantasy IV. This came out in July of 91 on the Super NES. That song was Fight One by Nobuo Uematsu.
This is the track that I imagine every time I see a Final Fantasy battle, like on a screen or in a video or in a commercial, this is the music that plays in my head.
Really?
This is like the iconic battle music. Because it's the first battle music that I really like. Got into. Thoughts?
This was probably my hardest track to pick because we wanted to pick one track from any given game, and I wanted to pick something from Final Fantasy IV, which is probably my second favorite. Six would be my favorite.
Okay.
But the music in this game I like over all the others. So this entire soundtrack could have been in for me. Damn Cyan Castle, the Red Wings. Fabul, any of those castle tracks or those overworld tracks or anything like that could have easily made it in for me. But I finally settled on Fight Song because it's just such a great battle theme.
Yeah.
I love the bass line, the horns when they come in, when it gets orchestral later on in the song. It's just such a great track.
Yeah, I love the blasting horns at the beginning. And as we were listening to it, I kind of pointed out to you guys, because Uematsu is a really big fan of 50s American rock. So once that bombastic horn section ends and it kind of slides, you get that 50s rock chord progression in the bass underneath those horns. And it was just a really cool throwback to like his old Rad Racer stuff. I really liked it.
I really enjoy the more uplifting orchestral parts of the song, actually. After the bass line, because the bass line, that beginning bass line is so iconic for Final Fantasy battle themes. I mean, pretty much almost every Final Fantasy has that do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do. Like, that's how things start off in most games. After those horns, and you've got that more sweeping, moving melody that kind of builds with the orchestral, kind of uplifting, filled with tons of different harmonies, that's probably my favorite part of the song.
Yeah, mine too.
Yeah, I really love that stuff. So as far as Nobuo Uematsu, of course, he's composed very many of these soundtracks, in fact, almost all of them. So we're gonna kind of glaze over Uematsu one more time. Just to kind of go into a little bit more information.
With a nice sugary coating?
Yes.
Like a donut? Glaze them over?
Tasty.
Delicious.
Yes. Delicious Nobuo Uematsu donuts.
They're all square donuts.
Yeah, they're all square, of course. Yeah, yeah. They're like those cheesecake squares at Dunkin' Donuts.
Oh, stop. Now I'm getting hungry.
Yeah. He's got a lot of different range in terms of, diversity in terms of music. Of course, classical music, heavy metal, new age type stuff, electronica, Celtic music, Irish music,
American
blues, American, like 50s rock, like, you know, sock hop type stuff. he's got a pretty wide range, so he also likes a lot of, like, Jimi Hendrix. As far as the games, his first title was Cruise Chaser Blasty, and he co-composed that with Takashi Uno, and then later did Alpha, King's Knight, and this is right around the time when he started picking up with Square, where he hooked up with Square, and 3D World Runner, he did the composition on that. You know, skipping ahead, because we could be here all day, he did Rad Racer, which I know you, Ed, you said that
huge fan of the Rad Racer soundtrack, yeah.
And then he, of course, started doing Final Fantasy. So he did, you know, the first Final Fantasy, jumped ahead, did Final Fantasy 2, 3. He also did Rad Racer 2, which I didn't even know there was a sequel to Rad Racer.
Yes, sir.
Is it just as good as far as the soundtrack goes?
Well, the soundtrack is great. Yeah. The game itself wasn't as good. That's why it's not as popular.
Ah, that's why. Did the Game Boy games like Final Fantasy Legend 2, Final Fantasy 5, Romancing Saga, he did an arrangement for. Chrono Trigger, he worked with Yasunori Matsuda and Noriko Matsuda. So, Final Fantasy 7, 8, 9, 10, you know, the whole enchilada as far as Final Fantasy goes. Blue Dragon, which was, I believe, an Xbox exclusive, right? Xbox 360, I think it was an exclusive. There's been tons and tons and tons of ports of these games, of course, so Nobuo Uematsu is, you know, credited on almost all of them. He also did work on Super Smash Bros. Brawl. You know, I'm jumping around here, but the point is we'd be here all day talking about Nobuo Uematsu's work. Full of variety, full of life, and really good. What about you, Tan? What do you think about Final Fantasy IV? Because I've not really played the American version of Final Fantasy II, so tell me a little bit about this game.
It would be my second favorite Final Fantasy, as I mentioned.
Right.
Six would be my favorite. It's just Square in their prime. This is before all the Square Enix nonsense, but this is after they sort of cut their teeth on Final Fantasy I, which is a great game in its own respect, but it was sort of the beginning of those sort of styles of console games.
The early stages.
Yeah. The early stages. Enix had Dragon Warrior, and they both sort of were very similar, but Final Fantasy IV was really the first much more mature, at least in the United States, Final Fantasy game to come out. And it just had a great story, huge world, a lot of characters, great monsters and battles to fight. Just so much to the game, and I spent untold hours playing this game.
It didn't rely on a lot of those cinematic tropes that a lot of the later Final Fantasies, like they even kind of started that with Final Fantasy VI, where there were, you know, big sweeping scenes and lots of, you know, dialogue and stuff that you couldn't control. Final Fantasy IV was Final Fantasy at its purest,
in my opinion. I can agree with that,
yeah.
That's
you know, no fancy graphics, excellent music as usual, but you focused on the gameplay, you focused on your characters.
Well, the earlier Final Fantasy games, all the way up to 6, all the gameplay is based on these character classes that you can pick. So you pick from, like, a monk or a mage, like a red mage, white mage, black mage, that whole nine, you know, the whole nine yards, warrior.
Mobizu Lion.
And so each character class that you could pick, isn't it where you can change the class in 4, or you can't change the class?
Not for any given character. Each character is a different class, and later in the game you're able to choose your own party, so you can sort of choose which classes you want.
It's one of those games that I've always wanted to go back and play, and it'd be cool to check out. I mean, as far as the story, we could be here all day going over the stories for each of these games. We want to cut it simple and short, and basically, you need to play these games to experience the story. These are 30, 40-hour plus games, so we can't really dive that.
When it comes to a point where we're playing a song,
right,
where you know, there's a specific story point,
right,
and it makes sense within the song, we'll talk about that.
But, sure.
You know, obviously, to explain the plot line of a Final Fantasy is both going to be full of spoilers and way more time than we have to spend.
Yes.
We do want to keep the cast under 4 hours.
We do, yes. So let's go ahead and move on to the next track. Now, this was, again, Todd's pick. This was Final Fantasy Legend 2, which came out in November of 91, so a little bit later in the year for the Game Boy. And this song is called Theme of a New God, and it's by Nobuo Uematsu and Kenji Ito. Thank you.
Welcome back. That was Final Fantasy Legend 2. The track was called Theme of a New God. And the soundtrack of the game was composed by Nobuo Uematsu and Kenji Ito. Now, originally in Japan, this game was not part of the Final Fantasy series. It was part of the Romancing Saga series, and it was called Saga 2 Hiho Densetsu.
That's correct.
That is correct.
That's all I know about the game, guys.
Good job, Ed. You get a
biscuit.
Biscuit. You get a mana biscuit.
You tried, buddy. You tried. Yeah.
Pat him on the head. Good boy. So, yeah, I haven't played any of these Game Boy games, but you obviously picked this track, Todd. So what?
I'm 15 or something, whenever this came out, and I love playing the Final Fantasy games, as I mentioned in the last segment, and they come out with portable Final Fantasy. Why would I not get into that? So yeah, I grabbed it. They're good games. They're solidly simplified RPGs for the Game Boy's much lower capacity for large worlds and whatnot. Mm-hmm. But good music, as you just heard. Not as many tracks, though. Very, very few. In this game, you are a band of warriors, as you know you typically are in Final Fantasy games. There's a legend about Magi or Magi or M-A-G-I.
Magi.
Magi, I guess.
Sure.
And there's 77 pieces of this substance, essentially crystals, and you have to go out and collect them all. It's a pretty simple story.
Pokemon.
77? God, it sounds like Banjo-Kazooie.
Yeah, right.
So you go out and you fight and whatnot. One of my big hang-ups on this game was when you were using equipment like swords, you had a number of uses on each weapon. Mm. So the sword could be used like 50 times. And when it ran out of uses, it was dead.
Mm. Yeah, yeah.
So you had to carry multiple weapons or multiple spells and whatnot on you in order to be able to continue fighting.
A lot of that in modern games nowadays, too. So I don't think that had been done before.
I don't think it was done before. No, before these came out.
No.
It became frustrating if you wanted to go out on longer sort of excursions.
Right. It kind of makes sense, though. I mean, I've not personally experienced that with too many games, especially of the Final Fantasy universe. So, but on a technical standpoint, I mean, your weapons are eventually going to be worn down. So that kind of makes sense.
But in a lot of those games, there's a way of repairing them. You can go back to town, or you have some sort of an item or something that will bring them back to their usable state. With these, you use them and they're done.
So the track was not only composed by Nobuo Uematsu, but also Kenji Ito, who's best known for his work on the Mana and the Saga series, which makes sense because this is part of the Saga series. He's done quite a bit of work, mostly for Square, and he actually left, very similar to Uematsu, who left Square years down the road. Kenji Ito actually left Square in 2001, and he became a freelance composer. However, he still does do work with Square, so obviously he didn't leave on a negative note. He's done work for Secret of Mana, Romancing Saga 1, 2, and 3, Tobal No. 1, which that has a really good soundtrack, Chocobo Racing, Chocobo's Dungeon 2, Sword of Mana, Shadow Hearts Covenant, Hero Must Die, Lux Pain. I mean, I could be here all day, but he has definitely kept up with continuing to be a proficient video game composer, if you will. As far as the track goes, it definitely has like a building feeling to it, so there's not really that many instruments in terms of like the sound and the arrangement of these tracks. That's one of the things about Game Boy tracks for non-action-based games, is when there's a lull in action, it kind of feels like nothing's really going on, and so because of that, the songs sometimes sound a bit flat.
I've got kind of a Baroque chamber music feel from this one. And it didn't really, you know, in RPGs when a lot of things aren't going on, you don't necessarily need crazy, complex music. So I think this just was a good mid-paced kind of, I don't want to say filler in the sense that it's a poorly composed song.
Right.
And it's just there to be there. But I think it's kind of fills that void of maybe an area in the game where there's a lot of dialogue or a lot of just wandering, maybe empty castle halls. So, Todd, do you know where exactly this plays in the game?
I don't remember. I just listened to the soundtrack and picked this track out, but it's been, you know, a decade or longer since I've actually played this game.
Right,
so. Yeah.
Right.
I mean, it's this Theme of the New Gods, so I'd imagine possibly in a church.
Yeah, or during some dialogue.
Kind of like a church organ feel to it. Maybe you can kind of take this melody in kind of different directions depending on how you wanted to arrange it. So I do feel like it's probably one of the more calm areas in the game, and if that were the case, then this would fit very, very well.
Right. going from a more portable title to a more console-based game, and a very easy one at that. This game is kind of the black sheep of the Final Fantasy series. I picked this track. It's Final Fantasy Mystic Quest, which came out in October of 1992. The track is called Battle Theme 1, and it's by Ryuji Sasai and Yasuhiro Kawakami. Welcome back. That was Final Fantasy Mystic Quest. Game came out in October of 92. The track is called Battle Theme 1, and that is by Ryuji Sasai and Yasuhiro Kawakami. Man, my neck hurts from headbanging to that track. Awesome.
Sounds like Natsume. No wonder you picked it.
Yeah. I'm just saying. So good. I don't know where to start. Amazing guitars. Really great like lead lines with the guitars. Awesome, like, synth solos, pounding
chimey
drums.
Chimey bells.
Wait, what?
Well, it's chimey bells.
You're chimey bells.
Sick burn.
Oh, yeah, chimey bells. Yeah, no, I totally got that now.
Derp.
I don't know, I was too busy listening to guitar. Just love it.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah. So for the people listening, we actually had to stop the recording, go back and listen to the song, because Mike didn't believe that there were chimey bells in the tune.
I didn't hear them.
So I had to refocus his ears, recalibrate his
refocus.
Sensory perception.
Yes. But yeah, this song's got it all. It's got a nice balance of softer moments where the track kind of quiets down a little bit, and then just kicks right back up. And one thing to keep in mind, of course, this is a battle theme. This is the first battle theme that you hear in the game. And the biggest problem that I have with this is the song is good throughout the entire track. And particularly the later part of the track is really good. It's really strong and heavy. And you don't hear that, like, which is a common complaint when you're playing these types of games, because you want to hear if the entire track is good, you want to hear the entire track, but you don't get to, because in these types of games, in role-playing games, you usually go for very short bursts of battles. So it'll be attack, attack, attack.
Unless
okay,
you're fighting Sephiroth.
Right, right. In which case, you know.
You can fight it over the course of 3 days.
Right, right. But in this game, all the battles are very, very quick, very fast-paced. And so you don't really get to hear the song the whole way through. So I'm like, oh, I wanted to listen to it a little bit more. And it's not one of those things where you can end the battle if you press like A or B or whatever, and then you'll be done with the fight. It's more like You won! Back to the traveling.
But the nice thing about this is before the action meters started, like, right, having enemies attack you without your control.
Yeah.
So you could literally just sit on the screen and let the song play out if you wanted to, mm-hmm, you know, just stop the turn-based.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, nice. It's not like they're constantly attacking you, which is good. Right. It's either you're attacking or they're attacking, but it's almost always that you're the first one to attack. This was Square's way of introducing to a much broader audience RPGs, role-playing games, and
it's like baby's first RPG.
Yeah, pretty much. And I'm okay with that, because my first RPG, in all honesty, was Chrono Trigger.
Yeah.
So, if I had played this when it came out, I would have really, really enjoyed it.
Yeah, Mystic Quest wasn't done in a disrespectful way,
right,
either. It was a good introduction, but it didn't talk down to the user. You know, it was simple. It had a decent storyline that,
right,
that wasn't babyish.
Right.
You know, it wasn't like, ooh, the giant monster with googly eyes is
right,
gonna take
not like
the world
that,
or anything like that.
It was
that,
just easy. And the problem with that is that these types of games are made for a much more, in my opinion, complex individual who wants to experience a grand story, you know, like an actual, like, book. It's like reading a book versus reading a magazine.
Yeah.
And so Final Fantasy Mystic Quest is essentially like reading a magazine, if you will.
Well, yeah, well, I would say more like maybe a young reader's novel.
Yeah, okay.
You know, like Nancy Drew.
Right.
Goosebumps.
Right.
Something like that.
Goosebumps.
Where, you know, so the gamer would be transitioning from, you know, an action game, to get into RPGs, and would kind of play this as an introduction to how the battle system works without having to worry about collecting materia, and then by the time you're done with this game, you have a good footing on how to play, like, you know, Final Fantasy VI or something that would come after that. Did you play this one, Todd?
I did, although I know Mike is playing it now.
Yeah.
I have not played it for a long time,
but
I remember certain things about it. I remember really liking that when you're fighting monsters, they deteriorate as they weaken.
Yeah, that's true.
And fighting skeletons,
they'll have like a little
start flying.
They'll have like a little band-aid like on their head to signify that they're hurt.
Right. I've always really liked
that
about
good,
that
good
game.
Good feedback for that younger player to see that they're, okay, I'm actually doing damage here. There's something going on.
Right.
Other Final Fantasies will have characters sort of like crouch down or something.
Right.
But it's much more emphasized in Mystic Quest, and that's one thing that I always liked about that game. Yeah.
So Ryuji Sasai was the composer of this particular track. He is very popular for doing lots of rock-based soundtracks. He was in rock bands himself. He's a vocalist and a bass player. We played a song from him once on the Fighting Games episode. He wrote the soundtrack to Bushido Blade 2.
Right.
And that was his last game from 98. So we played a track from that. That was one of my picks.
It strikes me that this game was made with Western audiences in mind, and the soundtrack plays to that as well.
Yeah, oh, absolutely.
So Sasai's music is very, like, balances that Eastern and Western kind of sound as well. So I think that it was very good that they picked him for this one.
Even the softer music and even the more orchestral music is still very high energy. So it works well for a crowd such as myself, who's more into action games. Playing this game for the first time, literally today, I sat down and played a little bit of it, and I really enjoyed it. Like, it was simplistic. It was definitely easy, and going from... It's kind of what I needed, though, because I'm so used to being intimidated by RPGs and being like, oh, 60 hours? Like, I don't have the time to devote 60 hours to one game. But if I can beat a game in, like, 10 hours, and I have, you know, even if it's a really basic story, but I'm still enjoying the gameplay and I want to beat an RPG, this is a game that I'm actually going to sit down and finish. And I think that's really important to keep in mind, is you don't have to devote a lot of time to learn a really complex battle system. You can play this game literally and drink a cup of coffee in your other hand. So,
all right, so there's one other composer that worked on this game, Yasuhiro Kawakai, and he worked with Sega for a little bit between 1987 and 1989. He did Shinobi, Scramble Spirits, the arcade version of Tetris, and Crackdown. Moved over to Kemco for one game, North and South, on the NES. He did the arrangement of Hiroyuki Masuno's tracks. And then moved over to Square in 92 for Final Fantasy Mystic Quest, along with Sasai. Ruju no Hiho, he did the sound programming for that. Tobal number 1, which, like, I think all of Square's composers had a hand in
except
that.
Except for Uematsu,
pretty much.
Yeah.
And then his last game was in 98. He did Chocobo's Dungeon 2 with composition alongside Kumi Tanioka, Tsuyoshi Sakito, and Kenji Ito.
So there's
those names popping back up.
Yeah. No, it's a really cool game. I suggest checking it out if you haven't yet. Who knows? There may be a dude you haven't played this game in the future. Next game that we're gonna play from is Final Fantasy V, and that came out in December of 92, so only 2 months after Final Fantasy Mystic Quest.
Two different countries, though.
Yeah, true. Final Fantasy Mystic Quest came out October 92, only in the US, for starters, because, of course, it was designed for Americans, and later released, ended up releasing in Japan, and then later Europe under a different title. But for Final Fantasy V, that came out only in Japan, never saw a release outside of Japan other than in Game Boy Advance format, which it came out in later on, and then, of course, through various ports throughout the years. December 92, the game came out. Tenderness in the Air is the name of the track, and, of course, it's composed by Nobuo Uematsu. Welcome back. That was Final Fantasy V, and that track was called Tenderness in the Air. Daw. Came out in 1992, December. Nobuo Uematsu was the composer, and it's just a really nice, laid-back, chill, like, town track.
This track reminds me of a lot of my ex-girlfriends.
Yeah? Really?
Very pretty, very sweet, very, very boring.
Oh, damn. Mess up. Sorry, Tanya from Student Study Hall.
Wow. How'd you know?
I just knew.
No, I'm just kidding.
You look like you dated a girl named Tanya.
What? I won't name any names.
Tanya. this was my first experience with an older Final Fantasy game, and I completely fell in love with this game. I still haven't beaten it, unfortunately, but it was one of those games that I was like, okay, I need to, like, I really enjoyed it. This game came out for the Super Nintendo, but only in Japan. It later saw a port to the PlayStation 1 with a combination of, it was Final Fantasy V and Final Fantasy VI, if I recall. And it came with a disc of music that was kind of like a compilation, like a best of. And man, I burned through that disc so many times. This track in particular, I would fall asleep to. Like, a lot, actually.
While you're playing the game?
No, like, I would put this soundtrack on, Final Fantasy V soundtrack, and I would just listen to it and chill out, and I would fall asleep, like, almost every night. I love this soundtrack. It's just got a really great blend of the orchestral and the more, like, rock-based tracks that Uematsu is just really famous for. As far as the game itself goes, won't delve too much into the plot. You play as this character named Bartz, which is Bartz with a Z at the end, which, why? There's this meteor.
Maybe farts.
Yeah, true. Or Butts. I would name him Butts. I don't know why. Like,
that
Butts,
works.
Bartz. Fallen meteor, just this meteor crashes to the ground, and Bartz is hanging out with his chocobo buddy. He goes to investigate, and he meets up with a bunch of characters, and he finds out that they need to gather these four crystals. And
crystals? The hell you say?
Crystals. Four crystals that basically were sealing this evil sorcerer named X-Death. And so Bartz meets all these different characters, like Ferris the Pirate,
who's actually, I always thought it was a guy, but it actually turns out it was a woman. And they kind of like, early in the game, they didn't really kind of show you. And it was very difficult to tell with Yoshitaka Amano's pictures that he drew. Because Yoshitaka Amano, very famous Japanese illustrator.
Everybody's effeminate in an Amano painting.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah. And so you really couldn't tell. It was very difficult to tell whether which character was male or female, other than like the older character Galif, who's obviously an older mustachioed man. I'm not going to obviously delve too much into the story because we have limited time. The job system in this game is really cool. You could pick from like being a monk or being a white mage, black mage, a fighter. And actually the Game Boy Advance port of this game saw like a huge increase of various different types of jobs that you can get. And so even though I didn't get very far in the PlayStation 1 version, I have the Game Boy Advance port of this game. And I, again, still haven't sat down and played it. But I really enjoyed the game from what I played. I got pretty far, maybe like 10, 15 hours in, and I enjoyed it. So what about you? Have you...
I've played it. I have not. It's one of the games that I've played but not finished.
Okay.
Obviously didn't get it on release. It was only released in Japan.
Right.
Ended up picking it up on the PlayStation Anthology
Same
that
as me.
Came out.
Right. I hated the loading times. They were abysmal.
Awful. And and graphically simple. Like I don't know what... I feel like it could have loaded the entire game into memory and just...
Oh, but... it was horrible load times. But the Game Boy Advance port cut down on that. And that's why I got rid of that copy and ended up picking up the Game Boy Advance port.
I never got that one.
Oh, no.
But I played probably the first 10 or 15 hours.
Yeah. I remember playing it on the Super Nintendo as well. Like, I went back and downloaded a hack of the game, a translated version. And I just personally couldn't tell the difference because at that point, I never played the Game Boy Advance version of it. So I didn't have anything really to compare it to. It's always been one of those things where, unless you've played the game in English... and it's an official translation, you have nothing to compare it to in terms of the Japanese version of the game if it ever got like translated by fans. So,
right.
Yeah, soundtrack is great. Game is fun. A lot of really good... I like that they get to the action right away. And again, I've said this before in the past. I need an RPG to immediately as possible get to the action. And if I have to watch like a 20-minute cutscene of dialogue back and forth, like, hey, how's it going? Oh, you gotta save this stuff. Oh, that's cool. So, tell me about your family. Like, you know, what's your brother like? Like, that... forget it, man.
No, all-encompassing evil.
Yeah. Like, I need that to happen as soon as possible.
And Final Fantasy is not good for that. They're very good at having a long introductions, lots of...
Newer games are.
Lots of story, lots of background, lots of world building.
It depends. It depends on the game. Like, that's what I'm saying. 5 is more like Mystic Quest in that sense, where the story starts pretty much right away. I mean, you're... Or at least it keeps you engaged. Like, stuff is happening. Like, meteors crashing and, oh, what's going on? Oh, let's run over here. Let's meet this character. Like, that's all cool. But if you get, like, a situation where the game opens up and it's just, Hi, I'm talking, now you're talking. Now I'm talking, now you're talking. Now I'm talking, now you're... And it's just that for like 20 minutes. I'm like, nope, I'm done. Just throw the game out. Throw
visual
it in the
novel
dumpster.
Of a game.
Yeah, pretty much. I just need a little action just to keep me intrigued. So
that's what she said.
That is what she said. Hey-o. So let's move on to the next track. This is Todd's pick. Todd, why don't you tell us about what game you picked?
This would be Final Fantasy VI, my favorite game. Although I haven't played it in a while. I should probably get back and play that again. Probably thought of as one of the best games in the series, generally.
The game came out in April of 1994 for the Super Nintendo Entertainment System, originally called Final Fantasy III in North America. The game is actually Final Fantasy VI. The track is called Edgar and Sabin, and that track was composed by Nobuo Uematsu. Let's hit it. Thank you.
Here's a sneak peek at a brand new show coming soon on the NES Network.
This is a fictional story.
A totally fictional story.
Of seven strangers.
Make that eight, whatever!
Picked to live in an apartment.
And have their lives taped.
To find out what happens.
When people stop fighting evil.
And finally start living in a fantasy. Look, a train.
The Real World Nigger.
Hi, I'm Tifa. So it's move-in day. We're living just south of my bar, the Seventh Heaven. I've met a few of the people here, and it's going okay, so far. Though, I thought this was an 18 and older show, and well, Onion Knight seems very underage.
Hey lady, I just look young. But trust me, just because you're the most popular doesn't mean you're the best.
Do you mind? I'm trying to do my interview.
You landlubbers don't know how good you got it. Squishing your toes on soft ground. Not risking splinters if you go barefoot like on my ship. And look at this! Forks!
We get it, Ferris. You're a pirate. Do you have to bring it up all the time?
Yes, Auron. Yes, I do. Did I mention I'm definitely not a lady as well?
Do you mind, Cecil?
Huh? Oh, I was just, inspecting your shirt there, Tifa. What is that, white cotton?
You don't have to stare, you know. We're gonna be living together, so you may as well get used to them, it, whatever.
Don't mind if I do.
Actually, I do.
Oh, don't tell my wife Rosa.
Hey, Selfie, what are you looking at out there?
Hey, guys, look out the window!
I don't believe it, guys. Guys, oh my god, here it comes. It's a train! It's a train! I f***ing love trains. Trains are so great. Hey, guys, come here. Come look at the train. It's got a steam cloud, and it goes... And I bet there's a conductor on board, and tickets. Oh, I love the ticket stubs. They're so cool.
What's her deal?
She's apparently really into trains. More like, what's your deal?
I'm a ninja. So what?
Talk about out of place.
Do not cast a shadow over our group, Miss Lockhart.
Oh, funny. Cause your name's Shadow. Clever.
Why don't we go up to my bed and I'll show you my little dog?
Excuse me, I don't know what kind of girl you think I...
No, seriously, I have a little dog. His name's Interceptor. He likes belly rubs.
Aw, how cute.
Whatever!
Wait, Squall's here? I thought we already had someone from Final Fantasy VIII.
He's more or less just a guy on the couch who's super negative and emo.
Whatever! God! Leave me alone!
Squall! Hey, Squall! Trains!
I love trains!
Oh boy, this is gonna be a long 3 months. Better stock up on potions.
The Real World Midgar, premiering this fall, only on the NES Network.
NES Network!
Welcome back. That track was from Final Fantasy VI, and that was an April 94 release for the Super NES. Edgar and Sabin was the track, and that's by Nobuo Uematsu. Just really booming kettle drums. That's what I take from that track.
And booming horns, too.
Yeah, true. I mean, this was one of those early games in the Super Nintendo where you could hear individual instrumentation of the music. And I dig it.
Not my favorite from the soundtrack, but, you know, I don't really care for that hugely, like, inside the castle kind of
definitely
music myself.
That's what I get from this. It's definitely an inside the castle moment.
It is, and it's one thing that what I like about this track is how like boastful and sure it is. It's very...
I think you said the same thing about the Fabul track when you played it on
the
previous
podcast. Yeah, mm-hmm. and it's that same kind of thing, and Nobuo Uematsu is great at putting that across when you go into one of the characters' homes, in effect. I mean, they're castles, but you know that's where these characters live. Putting forth their strength and their intentions.
It's almost like telling their personality via music.
Right. He's really good at that.
This game has one of the largest playable casts of any of the Final Fantasies in terms of characters, but all the characters are, for the most part, very fleshed out.
Yeah.
I mean, this is one of the first really in-depth stories for the Final Fantasy universe, I would say. I mean, all the others...
One of the biggest...
Yeah, one of the biggest.
And there's mechs. I mean, come on, there's mechs. That's all I need to know.
Yes.
Just go play it. There's mechs.
Is that what sold you? The mechs?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
This is the
Well, the fact that, you know, like I said, I'm not a fantasy guy, mm-hmm. so this kind of added a little more of a technological feel to the game, which obviously 7 really fleshed out.
Right.
But this kind of started hinting at the idea that there might be some 20th or 21st century technology mixing with all the fantasy aspects of these games. So I really kind of glommed onto that and enjoyed that aspect of
it. It was the first Final Fantasy that wasn't set in a more medieval world, but more like a steampunk sort of renaissance kind of world.
Like
lots of machinery and industry and that kind of thing going on in this particular world.
Industry! Technology!
Mechs!
As far as the characters go, they all have their own personalities. I mean, they've continued with what 4 and 5 were kind of establishing, where you have these characters that have their own personalities, their own background, their own stories. It wasn't just like 4 random people trying to save a bunch of crystals. It was, hey, you know,
it was 20 random people trying to save a bunch of random
crystals. Yeah, it's more of a situation where you're just trying to fight the bad guy and try to defeat the bad guy, which
it is a very, Kafka in this very game. Final Fantasy-esque, like, random people band together and try to fight this world-encompassing evil that has dominated the world, and it is up to you. You are pitted against them, and there's a
rebellion?
Rebellion.
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 Yes.
There's a rebellion that is being talked about in basements and behind bars and in secret locations that the all-encompassing evil doesn't know about.
It's kind of very Star Wars almost. It's
in that way,
like,
yeah
because there's this like evil empire.
Well, it's a classic tale. It's it's a story that, you know, is
the few against the many.
Right.
Exactly.
Character selection is very full of variety. I mean, you've also got these very like strong female characters that are not just like help save me. It's more like, you know, you have like ex-generals and you know, people that are fighting for the cause of the rebellion.
Espers.
So, yeah.
And then the Magicite, which is like the crystallized essence of the Espers, which is basically like, I said Materia before, but obviously, yeah, I meant to say Magicite.
Right.
Materia was from 7.
Not to mention Gao, who's a feral character that you meet a little bit later in the game, and he's able to take on the attacks and the abilities of monsters as you meet up with them, which I thought was an interesting...
You also get the personification of the Moogles in this one. I don't think the Moogles existed in the prior games, right?
I don't think so, no. I think this is the first, at least U.S., I don't know if they were in 5, but
maybe,
I think this is the first U.S. introduction to Moogles.
Yeah, and Mog, who is a Moogle, is like these characters, these white furry cat-like creatures that have these little like red balls on their head, hung up by like almost like a string or like a little...
Little antenna.
Yeah, a little antenna, if you will. And so you kind of meet them and going through the game. I mean, like I said, I have not gotten very far in this game. I think I got to there's a part where there's like an abandoned train, I think, or a ghost train.
Yep.
That's where I stopped playing. So I got pretty far.
Pretty far, but there's still quite a bit of game to go.
And I've heard there's this like opera moment, which is like people have like cried over this. It's like almost like an heiress sort of thing from Final Fantasy VII, and I've not played that part of the game, so it's always been one of those like things where it was like I wasn't in the loop, so like people would talk about it and I'm just like, yeah man, it's like when you
the opera scene,
the opera scene, yeah, no, totally, yeah, I feel you, yeah. And so a lot of these people that, you know, really love this scene or really love this game, whenever I talk to them and I'm like, yeah, no, Final Fantasy VI is a really cool game, I haven't beaten it, and then they're just like, they look at me like I have, like, 3 heads. They're just like, really, dude? Like, seriously? Like, you beat 7, but you didn't beat 6? And I'm like, yeah, sorry.
Sorry.
So, it's one of those games that I have, like, complete that I just sits on my shelf, and I'm like, oh, I really need to get back to this game. I've gotten far, but just not far enough.
That should have been one of your New Year's resolutions, man.
It was last year, actually. I was like, I'm going to beat Final Fantasy 3 or 6. I'm like, yes, it's going to happen.
It's going to be that one of those games that you dump 100 hours into, though. It's not something that you're going to be able to finish
exactly
at all.
Exactly.
It's just not possible.
And that's why it's intimidating to me. I'm just like, oh, I can't do it.
Eventually.
Yeah.
Once you're old.
One of these days.
Sitting in a retirement home.
Yeah.
Break out your ancient SNES.
I'm going to play Final Fantasy VI.
I died! These kids in their Final Fantasy 48.
Yeah. When I was your age. Shaking my imaginary cane.
All right, let's get on to the crowd favorite, shall we?
What's that?
That would be Final Fantasy VII.
Ooh, I may have heard of this title.
I believe I have, too. This is actually one of my pick for a change. I think this is the first one of the show.
Yeah.
This is Cosmo Canyon. Final Fantasy VII came out in 1997 for the PlayStation, and this is composed by Nobuo Uematsu. Welcome back. That was Cosmo Canyon from Final Fantasy VII, otherwise known as Final Fantasy VII. That was released in...
What?
Well, you know, all the games
up until now. Seven US, Japan.
Yeah, this was the first Final Fantasy game that released in North America that actually had the right number.
Yes, so past this point, we don't have to clarify which country we're...
Second.
What?
Final Fantasy I.
Oh, yeah, that's true. I forgot about that.
Yeah, okay. All right, fine. Rain on my parade.
It's giving him this, like, really, dude? Look.
technically correct thunder. Is the best kind of correct.
Yes. Okay, all right. Well, anyways, from now on, we don't have to delineate because we didn't pick Final Fantasy I for this podcast anyway.
That's true.
So, 1997 was the year. Cosmo Canyon was the track. And I just kind of got weird looks from everybody when I told them this is my favorite Final Fantasy song from the whole Final Fantasy universe.
Yeah, I'm still giving you a weird look.
Yeah, I just love the build up in this track. Mike is looking at me. I don't even know what kind of look that was.
I was not actually giving you a weird look. Maybe I should. And then I like grit my teeth and like open my eyes really weird. And,
yeah. Like he was preparing for a
murder.
Materia ball.
Yes. Yes.
Anyhow, so this track plays in Red 13's area. So it's just a very Native American, like...
Pretty
exactly
tribal.
How it sounds, Cosmo Canyon. There's, like, you know, big night sky overhead and very red, dusky ground with lots of canyons everywhere. And the music is inspired by Native American music. And it's just one of those melodies that I just can't get out of my head once I hear it. And I just whistle it over and over again. My favorite part of the song is that slow... build up. It takes like 16 bars from the time it starts to the time it ends right before the song loops again.
Right.
I just get goosebumps every single time I hear that build up. It just works so well. And so I hadn't heard this song in quite a while, and it just came up on shuffle on my MP3 player one day, and it just took me right back to the game. And so I decided I was going to pick it for this show because it's probably one of the only pieces in the Final Fantasy series that's really sentimental for me, I guess.
Okay, alright. I can feel you on that. I really like the really subtle, like, MIDI guitar in this. The dun, 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 dun.
Yeah.
Really, it adds, I don't know, just like a layer of intrigue to me. if you will. I dig it. It's a good track. Good game. Fantastic game. This goes back and forth with Chrono Trigger as my favorite RPG of all time.
I'm going to ruffle a couple of feathers here.
Oh, boy. Oh, boy.
I don't like it.
You don't like 7?
No.
Really?
No.
Why not?
From what you said about 2 and 3, or 4 and 6, whatever you want to call them, I can understand why you don't like. You like the more pure Final Fantasy.
Right.
That seems to be the consensus of most people like you who have played the series very early on versus the people like me where, like, I started the series late, like very, very late.
Yeah, different expectations of what, you know.
And so I had played Chrono Trigger first, actually. That was my first RPG, and fell in love with it. And then when I found out about 7, I had known about 6, and I had known about the series all throughout, you know, the entire time, but I never really paid any attention to it. So when I saw 7 and I saw the character design and the art and everything, I fell in love with it. So I picked up the game, and I actually rented 7. From Hollywood Video, like, not thinking anything of it, like, oh, I'll just try it out. And then I was just like, oh, I need to own this. Like, it was like, I had to own it. And so I bought it, played it numerous times. One of my favorites, just fantastic. Love the characters, obviously. I'm a huge Tifa fan, but I like all the characters except for Kate Sith. Hate Kate Sith. I'm not a big fan of Yuffie either. So
I don't mind him. I liked all the characters.
Yeah.
This is also one of the first RPGs where, and what you said about Chrono Trigger kind of strikes that chord too, is that in Chrono Trigger, I think environment was just as important. It's almost like a character in and of itself.
Yeah, that's true.
You know, and in Final Fantasy VI, it was there and it was getting to be more important, but like in Final Fantasy II, it was all story and character.
Right.
Like, you know, here's some darker colors that represent that you're in a dungeon now, and here's green grass and blue sky that you know, you're in the overworld and the ocean and all that, but this is really where the environment was. You know, you look up and see that huge city of Midgar,
right?
And
it's intimidating.
It's much more cinematic and developing, and it kind of draws, some people might think that it draws a little bit more away from that focus on the characters and the story. So is that kind of like what you feel, Todd, or am I totally missing the mark?
No, I don't think that you're wrong on that. I don't know what it is about it. I don't know if it's its first foray into a 3D world.
Maybe.
Instead of pixels, which I very much like the older games, partially for the graphics. I liked the way that each game progressed a little bit in terms of the backgrounds and the effects and all of that. And while that it continues to be true in 7, 8, 9, etc., I just liked the pixel art. I really loved the pixel art.
Okay.
So it had strikes against it. In fact, like I mentioned in the beginning of the cast, I resisted getting a PlayStation for a long time.
Right. Really?
And that included not playing Final Fantasy VII when it first came out.
Now, you had mentioned earlier in the show that you were a staunch, you know, fanboy of Nintendo, which I'm also a pretty big Nintendo fanboy. But I actually made the jump and got a PlayStation, and that was my next system after the Super Nintendo. I actually sold my Super Nintendo and all my games so I could buy a PlayStation just to play games like this. So would you say that when you saw Final Fantasy VII, when they were originally talking about putting it on the 64, that you maybe were more into that look of the game?
Oh, definitely. I would say, to use a modern term that the kids are all using these days, I was very salty. That Square kind of snuffed Nintendo.
That was all Nintendo's fault.
That was Nintendo.
It totally was.
Yeah,
at the time, I didn't realize that.
Yeah. Right.
At the time,
we didn't
know
the backstory.
I was 15 or 16, and all I knew was that Square. Yeah.
You need how many gigabytes to make this game?
Right.
Well, not even the size. Like, I didn't understand the size differences. Yeah. All I understood was one of my favorite game series was not coming out on a Nintendo system.
Right.
And I said, well, that's it. I'm not playing Final Fantasy anymore. Mm-hmm. And I was really hung up on that for a long time.
A lot of people forget that the series originally came out on Nintendo platforms. It was exclusive to Nintendo systems. And when it jumped ship to PlayStation and became almost like a PlayStation exclusive series, people were... Like, nowadays you talk to people and they're like, oh, when I think Final Fantasy, I think PlayStation. And all us old schoolers are like, no. Final Fantasy is a Nintendo franchise.
Yeah, right. See, I grew up at the same time you guys did, and I never considered that. I mean, but being kind of a platform agnostic guy, I was never a fanboy of any real particular manufacturer or company. So when Square games started coming out on PlayStation, I was like, oh, okay, cool. I guess I'm just getting a PlayStation if I want to play those games.
Right.
I never had that loyalty to Nintendo where I was like, damn you, you know, Sony, or damn you, Square, for going away from what I'm doing.
Yeah.
I was like, oh, okay, well, I have a PlayStation, now I can play Final Fantasy games and Square games too. So it's just a different take on what happened back then. And
Seven is just a phenomenal game. It's worth checking out. Even if you're not a huge fan of it, you should at least check it out if you haven't already.
I don't mean to say that I don't like it.
Sure.
It's just not my favorite Final Fantasy.
Yeah, no,
it doesn't rank as high in my list of Final Fantasies as it would for many other people.
You're more of a Mystic Quest kind of guy.
More of a Mystic, Mystic Quest right up there.
Oh, yeah.
he was never able to beat it, though. It was just too difficult.
It was just too hard
too
for
hard,
him. Poor
hard,
Todd.
Right.
All right, let's move on to the next track. This is Final Fantasy VIII. Came out in 1999. The track is called Balam Garden. It's by Nobuo Uematsu.
Why are you so mad? This is your pick.
No, I know.
What?
I'm getting to
all
that.
All right, we'll talk about it after the
God.
Song, weirdo.
Was Final Fantasy VIII.
Tell me you hear the bells on this one. Please tell me you hear the bells on this one.
I hear the bells.
Oh, thank God.
Yeah. The track came out in 1999. Balam Garden was the track by Nobuo Uematsu.
And I was just telling everyone this is what plays in the background when DJ's friend dies on Full House.
More towards the later part of that track.
That harmonica is totally like TGIF theme song.
I think of that song, You Got a Friend in Me. You know, you got a friend.
Yeah.
I think that. I also think Lionel Richie. I don't know.
I don't have enough experience
with
him.
I hate this game, man. I get so angry every time I think about this game because, let me share my experience with this game. Post Final Fantasy VII, hyped to the max for VIII. Just like, VII was so good. I'm so excited, so excited. Seeing all this character art, because this was like the first game that I learned about through the internet, or like one of the very, very early first games that I was like really getting excited about in magazines and everything in EGM. So I was so pumped for this game. They released all the action figures prior to the game even coming out, bought all the action figures, just like needed to have them. Staring at these characters and like not knowing really anything about them, just being like, this is so cool. Character design's really neat looking. Like, this game's gonna be amazing. Play the game. And I actually really did enjoy it in the beginning, but then it's like the personalities of the characters, I don't know. A lot of the characters felt very flat, very emo, especially Squall, the main character.
I think that's a big complaint about him from a lot of people.
He's kind of whiny. He's just, I don't know. And Cloud wasn't even that whiny. Like, Cloud was
just confused.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, Seven was more just like, hey, Cloud was this likable character that he was. You didn't really know that much about him in the beginning of the game, but like right off at the beginning of the game with 8, Squall is just like a complainer. Just like, oh, God.
He's like a little rain cloud, just like his name.
Squall?
Squall.
Squall is a short rainstorm.
Oh, all right then. Okay, didn't know that. You learn something new every day.
You didn't know that?
I really didn't know that.
Wow, okay.
No.
Well, right. There you go. Okay, now his name makes sense, right?
Yeah. So, and then you've got a bunch of other characters that obviously we're not going to talk too much about. My favorite character in this game was Quistis. I really liked Quistis. She was really cool. She was like the teacher of all the kids. And the whole game takes place in this school. And this track in particular takes place in Balam Garden, which is like part of the school, if you will. I spent so much time in this school that this track is like burned into my memory for this game. So when I think of this game, I think of this track. And so that's why I wanted to play it. Just really beautiful like harps and synth strings in this track. And then, as you said, the harmonica that comes in later towards the end. Where DJ's friend dies in Full House. That's hilarious. That might be the funniest thing you've ever said on the show.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that.
So anyways, getting to my hatred of this game, just to explain a little bit more about the game, the magic in this game is a draw system where you encounter enemies, you draw magic from them, and you kind of like have to farm this magic out of them.
So like Pictionary?
What?
Pictionary?
What do you mean?
You're drawing?
Drawing. Yeah.
Bad joke. Anyway,
yeah,
move
bad
on.
Joke.
I used all my bad joke karma.
Yeah, you did. Yeah. you tapped out with DJ in Full House. Yeah. You're drawing the magic out, so you draw fire, ice, whatever the case may be. And, you know, I didn't really mind that much. It was very time consuming, but overall, I enjoyed the game system. I enjoyed the soundtrack. I enjoyed playing the game. What killed me is the story. There's a part in the game which, if you want to skip ahead and you don't want to be spoiled, I'm not spoiling anything for you because this game sucks when you get to this part. There's a part in the game where, and this is deep in the game, it's like two discs in or whatever. You get to the part in the game where they all find out, there's these summons, like all throughout the series of Final Fantasy, there's these summons like Ifrit and Shiva and all these various different monsters that you can summon and they do like devastating damage. In 8, you find out later on in the game that
Ifrit is Squall's dad.
Yes, that Ifrit is Squall's dad. you find out that all of the characters used to know each other, but they forgot that they knew each other prior to them being at the school because of the guardian forces, these summons that they were using. My problem with this is that you don't start using summons until the beginning, like a little bit in towards the game. So your first one you have to get, and it's Ifrit, and you get him in a cave with Quistis. Quistis is like your teacher, and she goes in with Squall, and she's like, all right, we got to get this guardian force. We're like, cool. So you get the guardian force, you get the summon, whatever you want to call it, and then you start getting more of these things later in the game. So they should have always known that they knew each other throughout the entire time, but they don't. So I'm like, what the hell? Like,
did they forget how to use summons when they forgot they knew each other?
Yeah, like, it's stupid. Like, it's a huge, huge plot hole that they never... I shut the game off. As soon as I got to that part in the game, and I was like, wait a minute, they all knew each other, but they forgot because of the Guardian forces? I was like, f*** this game.
Wow.
Yeah. So, ever since then, I've sold the game and rebought the game 3 times, and I'm like, I'm gonna play through it. Like, I'm gonna get through it. I'm just gonna forget about that part in the game. Like, I wanna beat this game. And I get to that part every time and I'm like, f*** this game. And I sell the game. So now I'm on my 3rd repurchase of the game. And I've told myself this time I'm going to play through the game. I still, of course, haven't repicked the game up and started playing through it. But when I do, man, I'm not gonna say fuck this game.
Get through it, man. I mean, it's not like...
It's just so stupid. It's stupid,
but it's not something that, I don't know, wouldn't make me shut the game off.
I don't know.
You guys remember when a game's cool factor depended on how many discs it came on?
Yeah, yeah. Like, oh, it's got like 5 discs.
Oh, Final Fantasy VIII has 4 discs. That's so cool.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, well, it was just one of those things where you knew it would be like a really grand, big, epic adventure. So the more discs, the better the game in a lot of ways.
Out of that, there was a lot of FMV.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. Yeah, that's one of the big things about this game is it kind of extended upon the introductions and the cutscenes And this was one of the first times that you were like, look at those graphics. Like this, like you were blown away by the CG effects in this game. And it kind of became a staplehood of the series for these like long, really awesome, epic intros and cutscenes all throughout the game. And they were kind of scattered throughout the game for the most part, you know, yeah. Pretty well.
All right, well, let's move on to our next game. This is Final Fantasy IX, the first game to come out in 2000, or at least the first Final Fantasy game to come out in the year 2000. This is Jesters of the Moon, otherwise known as Zorn and Thorn's Theme, also by Nobuo Uematsu. Mike Hagar here. You may remember me as the ass-kicking mayor of Metro City. Everyone loved Final Fight when it came out, but my series became a bit stale over the years. Final Fight Pachinko didn't catch on very well, and Mad Gear Kart Racing drove directly into the bargain bin. I've decided to branch out, leave my comfort zone, and wander blindly into the world of RPGs.
This is a real bad idea, Mr. Mayor.
Shut up, Cody, I got this. Just because you married my daughter doesn't mean you can boss me around. An RPG is a video game, just like all the other ones we've been in. How hard can it be?
Well, okay then. You asked for it. Random battle!
Alright, I got this. Two slashes and a poison. Piece of cake. Wait. What? Ah, I can't move!
Your power meter isn't full yet, Dad.
I told you, don't call me that. Ouch! I still can't move. Why are they attacking me?
They're scrawny and fast, and you're literally an ox in khakis. Hold your horses. Okay, your meter is full. Attack now!
I still can't move.
Yell the name of your attack.
What?
Just do it.
Punch. Kick. Spinning pile driver.
You did it, Dad!
No.
No?
RPGs are not for this guy. I'm going back to beat-em-ups. Hey, you want to grab a bite on the way home? I hear there's a pizza ninja right around the corner.
Welcome back. That track was Final Fantasy IX, and that came out in 2000 for the PlayStation 1. Jesters of the Moon, Zorn, and Thorn's Theme was the name of the track, and that was by Nobuo Uematsu.
I picked this one because I thought it was fun.
Yeah.
I envisioned Zorn and Thorn, not having played Final Fantasy IX, as being kind of cool cowboy-type characters that might hang out at a bar, maybe with like kind of a joking, lighthearted side to them. And then after enjoying the song and looping it a couple times and saying, yes, this is the song I'd like to play for the show, I looked up the characters and found out that they were ugly jesters.
That doesn't surprise me because all the characters are really ugly in this game.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
That's the entire reason why I totally skipped this
game. I didn't talk too much about Final Fantasy VIII, but I agreed with you guys. I felt that it was not VII, you know, mm-hmm. It was not what I was expecting. Mm-hmm. And then I saw the artwork for IX and the characters for IX, and I was like, this doesn't even look appealing to me at all. And not to detract from people that enjoy IX, I mean, that's great, but it did not fit my idea of what I wanted to play in an RPG. Plus, they took a lot away from that whole sci-fi technological aspect. This was much more fantasy-based.
This was a return.
Again, it was like even less than I was interested in.
Yeah, this was a return to the more fantasy-based aspects of the series where they tried to bring it back and tried to dial it back because I would imagine a lot of fans were not... A lot of long-term fans like you, Todd, were probably not fans of what was going on with 7 and 8, where it was more sci-fi, more steampunk-ish, you know, 6, 7, and 8 kind of brought that on. 8 was very... I would probably say that 8 was the most far away from the original concept of the series, which was more fantasy-based, and this was way more sci-fi influenced. And so 9 was kind of a return to form. They had, like, you know, court jesters and... character classes and all that. So that's why I was surprised when you said during the break that you hadn't really played that much of this game.
I don't remember what it was about this game that...
Was it the characters? Really,
I don't know if it was the characters. Honestly, I can't say. I did play it, but it was another... Really, all of the PlayStation, the original PlayStation Final Fantasies, I only just... fairly recently played through 7 all the way to the end.
Oh, really? Oh, wow.
I did play it when I got my PlayStation, you know, several years after its release, but I didn't finish it. Mm-hmm. Same thing with 8, same thing with 9. But 9, I don't know, it never caught me. I didn't get interested in it, so I stopped playing.
So I liked 8 in terms of the character design. I liked, obviously loved 7 for the character design. 6, 5... I really enjoy, for the most part, most of the series character design. Probably not so much the earlier games, like 3, 2, 1. To me, they all feel like just generic warriors, kind of. So it wasn't until like 4 and 5 that I was like, all right, these characters have, like, you know, specific traits to them and specific looks to them. And there was a greater focus on design in that aspect, that they were actual real characters in a story. For 9... I just thought the characters were really ugly. And
they were like almost super deformed, but still kind of normal looking at the same time. Like very big heads and very skinny bodies.
Yeah, well, it was weird in 7 because you got that super kind of chibi look to the characters when they were on the map, when you were walking around.
Right, but the character art made them look like normal humans.
Yeah, like during fights.
Normal measurements.
Right. And that's what appealed to me, is I wanted to play as... I had mentioned this previously, that I don't want to play as little kids for the most part in RPGs. And so that's why I've stayed away from games like Earthbound and Mother, the whole Mother series, if you will. Final Fantasy, to me, always was, you know, late teens, early 20s characters fighting and doing stuff. And so their attributes should match that. And so with 9, all of the characters look like little kids to me, except for, like, that big knight guy. And so I was like, I don't really feel this. So I never picked the game up. That's the unfortunate part.
It has its fans, and its fans are staunchly defending of it. But that's any iteration of the series, really.
Yeah. The characters are colorful, and they look, you know, like, they all look different. I think for me to enjoy the game, it has to have an overwhelmingly large human cast of characters. Most of the characters should be human, and if they're not, then I'm less interested. But that's just me.
All right, so listeners, make your case for this game, because obviously the three of us here are not totally down with these clowns, Zorn and Thorn. head over to facebook.com/group/pixeltunesradio and let us know, like, some of these games that we're not that into. Make your case. Tell us why we should play them. Maybe we've missed something, because, like I said, none of us have really given a lot of time to Final Fantasy IX. So maybe if we can get past these character designs, we'll find something that we don't know exists, and we'd really like to hear that.
True. And as for the music itself, I enjoyed the track. I mean, that's one thing about the game I will say it's positive is the soundtrack is great. I've heard a bunch of the songs, and the songs are all really top-notch. This track in particular sounds like a saloon theme.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. That's why I thought Cowboys.
Exactly.
You know,
yeah.
It was
got
fun.
That raga piano style. It's good stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah. I often think of Six when I think of this track. Six and Five. Like, it kind of draws back to that more earlier sound of Final Fantasy. And I would say that this game sounds the best in terms of instrumentation of all the Final Fantasy PlayStation games. 7 is very MIDI. 8 has like little slips of MIDI in there. You know, it still has that Super Nintendo style in terms of the songs. But this song sounds like an actual piano, like actual old school,
and it's reggae, it's raga, sequenced music, mm-hmm. Just like the first two were, on the PlayStation 7 and 8, mm-hmm. But they've been doing sequenced music on the PlayStation at this point for like 4 years, so it's no surprise that they were able to create clearer samples. As time goes on, sound compression becomes better, so you can fit more realistic sounding samples into the memory for these, MIDI style sequenced songs. So, that increase in technology also helps the composers create more realistic sounding music without needing to resort to streaming audio, which takes a ton and ton of memory.
Right, 'cause
you'd
right.
end up with like a 72 disc game if you wanted live music. So speaking of live music, let's move on to Final Fantasy X. This was on the PlayStation 2 in 2001. This is Todd's pick. It's Oron's theme, again, from Nobuo Uematsu. Welcome back, that was Final Fantasy X, Oron's theme. This game originally came out on the PlayStation 2 in 2001. That's all I got.
That's it? You're tapping out?
Man, that's my...
Good night!
That's the wealth of my information about Final Fantasy X.
I did play this one. You play this one as well.
Oh, yeah, good, yeah, good. Yeah. I'll just sit back and enjoy.
Okay.
This game this game holds a place in my heart because when I met my wife, she was playing Kingdom Hearts, and that has a lot of appearances from Final Fantasy characters, mm-hmm. in it.
Right.
And she was really digging it. She's a big Disney fan, so she loved running around and being in all of those worlds. And like Cloud would show up or whatever, and she was really into that and the leveling aspect, but she had never really played RPGs before. This was like her sort of first, as an action RPG, but you know, foray into that. And I said, well, if you like this, let me show you Final Fantasy X. So she and I, when we first started dating, played this game together.
Okay.
And it was like
one romance built on video games.
On video games.
That's beautiful.
Aww.
Yes.
So
I couldn't do that.
Patty doesn't like
video games. No, my fiance does not. She's not a big fan of video games. And that's always been one of those things where I would like to find like a game that we could both really, really sit down and enjoy. And I think if there was a game, and several of her friends have actually mentioned this, that if there was a game that she could sit down and play with me through that she could get into, it'd be Final Fantasy VII. So maybe one of these days I'll, slip her a Mickey. Yeah, and
that's not gonna help her enjoy a game.
Sit her down, like tie her down to the couch, and be like, "You're gonna play Final Fantasy VII, and you're gonna like it."
You should try the Quantic Dream games.
The what?
Heavy Rain, Beyond Two Souls.
Yeah, yeah.
I've seen like the dramatic movies she likes to watch.
Right.
It's a very good introduction between.
That's true.
The shows she likes to watch and video. It might not be your bag.
Sure.
But it's something that could like a gateway, like Mystic Quest,
yeah.
kind of bring her into.
That's
playing
true.
Games.
Yeah, I'll have to.
Plus, she can use an iPad.
I like
or Beyond.
Yeah,
she can use something she's comfortable with.
Okay, all right, cool. I'll check it out. But for Final Fantasy X, I have played this one. I don't have the sentimental feeling that you had, but actually, this was a game that myself and a friend of mine played through, and we played through Final Fantasy VII as well. And I think I mentioned this on a previous podcast. Or if I haven't, then I at least have posted pictures of me back in like 2004 or something like that, where a bunch of my friends got together and we were like, let's play Final Fantasy VII. And so we beat Final Fantasy VII, and then we were like, what do you want to beat now? And we were like, Final Fantasy X. So we started playing through Final Fantasy X, and I don't know, the big complaint that I have about the game is the voice acting is atrocious.
It's not great.
It is really, really awful.
It's really bad.
It is. Just, and it's awkward and creepy. Like, there's these moments where Titus will just start laughing. Titus is the main character, who's like this blitzball player, and he finds out that his home city of...
He's kind of a dude bro.
He is kind of a dude bro, which is weird to play as a dude bro in a video game, especially a role-playing game.
Right.
And so, you know, the cast is full of a bunch of really cool, creative, different characters that all kind of... They fit together well, but they're all individually kind of awkward and weird. You've got Yuna, who's this more like spiritual character, and then you've got Lulu, who's like a goth mage. I don't know, very weird. But I dig it. I dug all the characters for the most part. I mean, they all had their moments of awkwardness, but I enjoyed playing as the cast of characters. But yeah, just like weird moments where Titus will just start laughing for no reason.
Everybody can always point at the laughing scene as just being one of those terrible scenes that...
Yeah.
It was supposed to be one of those really highly emotional moments.
Right.
And it just turned into like a
awkward,
joke.
Awkward, creepy, just like...
That was probably due to the terrible voice actor.
Yeah.
It was just like the voice actor's trying to... not even trying, really, to make the scene happen.
And this was such a huge leap for Square to make a game that had full voice acting. And so you were kind of expecting, with all the hype that this game had, it was the first game that came out of the Final Fantasy series on a new platform, like on a new generation console. So there was this huge leap in technology from Final Fantasy VII to Final Fantasy X, and I guess people were just expecting something different, and I think this is really where the series kind of fizzled, or started to fizzle, in terms of popularity especially, where there was this huge jump in popularity from 7 all the way up till 9, and then people kind of jumped.
I think it's as popular as ever. It seems what happens is when a new game comes out, people... Mm-hmm. hate it. Fans hate it.
Yeah.
But then after they have a while to get used to it and think more about it and explore the game more, they end up turning around just in time for the next game to come out. So now they're like, oh, this next game really sucks. Why couldn't it be more like 10, which was awesome?
So you're saying that when 15 comes out, people are going to love 13?
People are
going to
be
13.
Like, oh, but 13 was so great. What
is this? I can't ever picture
that. What is
that
this
happening?
Open world?
People hated 13, and you know, it was just such a huge departure.
I don't think 13, even with time, is going to save itself.
No,
I don't think it's going to.
10 stayed pretty squarely in the line. No, all puns aside from the name of the company Square, but this was also a Square Enix. I think this was one of the last Square games that it was Squaresoft. It wasn't Square Enix because they hadn't combined with Enix, so it was just Squaresoft. So this was kind of a lot of people. I remember this game coming out, and a lot of people did not like it.
But now a lot of people like it.
Yeah, I've always dug it. I've always thought it was pretty good.
Yeah, so. I always liked it.
Yeah, I got up to the part where I haven't beaten this one, but I've got up to the part pretty far in the game where I was using the strategy guide because I typically use the strategy guides as kind of like a, oh, let me see what I have to do next. So I would always follow along with the strategy guide. I don't know why, but these types of games, that was always my main focus. And because I wanted to collect everything. So part of that, in Final Fantasy X, there's this lightning that you have to dodge in order to get like one of the ultimate weapons for your character, for I think it was Tidus's ultimate weapon. And you had to dodge the lightning 210 times or something like that.
I think it was just 200, but
maybe
yeah,
it was 200.
It was a lot.
It was hard. It was hard to dodge it. So you would go like 14, 15, 16. Shoot. Okay. Let me start over. 10, 11. Shoot. Let me start over. And it was just one of those like grindy type thingies that I was like, nope, I'm done. And we stopped. We all stopped playing the game.
I think there was a point in the game where you had to do it maybe 20 times in order to continue with the game.
Right, right.
But then if you came back and did it 200 times, you got
the ultimate weapon.
The ultimate weapon one of the characters. I forget which one.
Because I was quite a completionist when it came to these types of games, I always wanted to experience everything in the title for the most part. And so that was one of those things that I was like, I want to get this weapon. This is going to be awesome. And I couldn't. And so because of that, I ultimately self-defeated myself into not wanting to continue the game. So it's always been one of those games, again, very much like 8 that I wanted to pick up. It's not that I disliked the game like I did with 8's story. It was more, it was just like, hey, you know, let's actually sit down and play this game. And I just haven't found the time. So
right,
maybe we'll all get together and play through a bunch of these games.
Let's do it.
Yeah. Cool. No, the track was... I don't know.
I liked it. I mean, clearly okay. I picked it.
Yeah.
I don't know. I just thought it was a good groove. Like, good...
Nice
sort of...
classic music sort of style.
Yeah. Well, it's more like a easy rock, like John Tesh style. That's kind of what I thought when I first... Started off kind of like Billy Joel.
It's got these
kind of
weird...
A little bit maybe Elton John in there.
Synth moments, though.
Like strummy guitars with pianos.
Yeah, but it's got these like... Like
kind of
electronic.
Like Elton John style. He did a lot of experimental electronic stuff.
I didn't know that about Elton John. Okay. What about you, Todd?
I really liked what you were just talking about.
Yeah.
I like that a lot. And it's just like a real chill soundtrack. It's like you can kick back with a mojito or something and just jam to it. I don't know. I like it.
I didn't say the track was... I don't think the track was bad. I just think... I didn't take anything away from the track. The one thing I will say... That I noticed that when Ed and I were listening to the track, we were kind of tapping along, but we were tapping our own like little drum medleys.
Yeah,
it
had very weak
it.
Percussion.
Yeah, the percussion in this is very light, and I really wanted it to be stronger, like more like a pitter patter, like an electronic pitter patter that could match that electronic sound to the track that it kind of had, kind of luring in the background. But yeah, then I heard classical rock.
Well.
In this.
If you want stronger percussion, let's move on to our next track.
Oh, yeah? What's our next track?
Next track is Soldier Battle from Final Fantasy VII Crisis Core. So this is the side story to Final Fantasy VII released on the PSP. This is Soldier Battle from Takaharu Ishimoto. We'll be right back.
Welcome back. That was Crisis Core Final Fantasy VII. And that track is called Soldier Battle. The game was released in 2008 for the PSP. It was an exclusive to that handheld. The track was composed by Takaharu Ishimoto. And I enjoyed this game. I haven't beaten it, but I got pretty far in it. It was really one of the few reasons why I actually got a PSP. And it continues the story of Final Fantasy VII, kind of like a prequel story, if you will.
Right.
It takes place basically prior to Final Fantasy VII. And you play as Zack Fair, who is mentioned during Final Fantasy VII, but you don't really see him all that much. So you kind of take on...
I mean, kind of like in dream sequences.
Yeah, dream sequences and just like aforementioned like discussions of who Zack was. Zack was basically Aeris's boyfriend. So...
more or less.
Yeah. As far as the track goes, just really solid, like, awesome hard rock metal track. You mentioned Soundgarden during the break.
Oh, yeah, totally.
Yeah.
After, see, well, the guitar part that comes in at the beginning, that's like the motif of the game. So
right.
You hear that melody appear throughout the game.
Right.
And the soundtrack. And then Soldier Battle plays, I think it's like the final battle of the game. So this is kind of like where that whole motif is leading up to. And so after that, it just breaks into this like real Soundgarden-style guitar riff that I absolutely love. The whole soundtrack it's got a lot of like synth and symphonic in it, but then throughout the game and all the battle scenes, there's these really hard rocking tracks.
Yeah, which they kind of
really good.
They kind of continued that from the Advent Children Final Fantasy VII movie.
Yep.
That came out, the CG movie, and a lot of the tracks were just like redesigned tracks from the original game, like One Wing Angel. They did like a Jimi Hendrix meets epic, awesome hard rock sound to it. So it's really crushing. The guitars sound really thick and meaty. And as far as the drums are all pounding, really like heavy. It's not like heavy, heavy metal, but it's just like it's good hard rock and metal. You know, very similar to, as we said, Soundgarden. So I dug it. It's good stuff.
Yes. The cool thing about this game is that it kind of deals with Sephiroth before he became the big baddie from Final Fantasy VII.
True.
And there's this amazing full motion video sequence during the game. It's about probably a little less than halfway through, but it's Zack and Genesis and Sephiroth all fighting this battle against each other on this huge spire that's coming out of this wall.
Right.
Like chopping parts of the spire off as they're flying around and like attacking each other. Really, really cool hard rock music playing in the background. Like, that was... I still remember that sequence in my mind from playing through the game. That was probably the coolest thing. You know, on par with anything that was in Advent Children. They did a really, really good job on the full motion video sequences. The CG was definitely where Square was kind of at their
peak.
Their height
yes.
of storytelling in that kind of format.
You had mentioned Genesis. Genesis is one of the characters that they introduce along with Angeal. And you also see a little bit more of the background of the soldier group that Cloud belongs to. So you kind of get a sense as to where Cloud came from and how he relates to Zack a little bit more in this game.
It's hard to say a lot without spoiling Seven and Crisis Core.
That's true. But I think that if you dug Seven, you'll probably dig this because it kind of...
It's closure, basically.
Right. Yeah, a lot of it's closure. What Square did was they came out with a series of games around the PS2, late PS2 era, where they came up with Final Fantasy VII Dirge of Cerberus, which is a game where you play as Vincent Valentine, and this game you play, as far as Crisis Core, you play as Zack, and then, of course, they came out with Advent Children, the movie, which has all the characters in it, and that's an actual sequel, as far as the story goes, to the original Final Fantasy VII game. So what you kind of get is this overall like environment and feel to the story in the game. It kind of fills out the lore, if you will, in regards to Final Fantasy VII and the universe. So it's cool. I dug pretty much every version that they threw at me because I really love the characters and I love the story. So
yeah,
it was good.
Totally worth it to play. So the composer on the game, Takaharu Ishimoto, he started off in 1999 on Legend of Mana as a synthesizer programmer. After that, did a bunch of the All-Star Pro Wrestling games. And then as a composer, His first game was in 2002 for World Fantasista, and did some of the mobile games of Final Fantasy VII Before Crisis and Last Order in 2004 and 2005. Those came out on some phones. The World Ends With You in 2007, as well as Crisis Core in 2007, and then worked on a lot of the Final Fantasy side stories from 2008 to 2015.
And sequels of Kingdom Hearts, too.
Right, like Dissidia, Kingdom Hearts Birth by Sleep, Final right. Fantasy Type-0, Kingdom Hearts 3D, etc., etc. His last game that he was credited for was just last year, which was Dissidia Final Fantasy.
That was the Koei Tecmo joint collaboration with Square Enix and their fighting series Dissidia, which we'll talk about in a little bit.
Absolutely.
Yes, but our next track is actually a game that I've never played, but you picked.
Yeah, yeah, this is a DS game from 2010. This is Final Fantasy, The Four Heroes of Light. The song title is Strong Enemy, and it was composed by Naoshi Mizuta. Welcome back! That was Final Fantasy, The Four Heroes of Light. It was a side story game on the Nintendo DS. Came out in 2010 from Naoshi Mizuta, the composer which hasn't had too much experience on the Final Fantasy series so far. And this was a game that was kind of designed to be a throwback to earlier Final Fantasy titles, noted for its like maze-like towns and more like a labyrinthine dungeons and makes it a little bit difficult to get through. But it had random encounters and a lot of the stuff that kind of went by the wayside when the more modern Final Fantasy games came out. The cool thing about this game is that there was a sequel planned for it, but that sequel eventually developed into the games that we know as Bravely Default.
Right.
So if you enjoy the Bravely Default games, you can go back and check this one out and you'll probably see a lot of similarities between the two series.
Yeah, they said that this game was kind of like a piecemeal sort of thing, whereas like they took little bits of inspiration from past games, like from Final Fantasy III and Final Fantasy V. They used the crown system and Final Fantasy IV for the story and the character design and everything. And even looking at like earlier old school RPGs such as Final Fantasy 1 through 3 and Dragon Quest 1 through 3. So there's a lot of inspiration for this title from the past. And I think that kind of shows immediately, even on the character art, when you're first looking at the character art, all the characters are smaller, they're littler, they're more like Bravely...
They're more like the Final Fantasy V games.
Yeah, yeah. Except they're not adults, they're kids, which again, that throws me off, because I'm like, no, I'm good.
Yeah, I think they said the protagonist is 14 years old.
Yeah, which I'm like,
No, I'm good.
It's probably the age they were going for this game, though. It was kind of like this generation's Mystic Quest, in a sense, kind of getting into that whole RPG
deal.
So the composer Naoshi Mizuta started off as a Capcom employee, worked on Street Fighter Alpha, Resident Evil 2, and Rockman and Forte, and then moved over to Square to do Parasite Eve 2, Final Fantasy XI, and the standalone Tetra Master game. And then did a lot of the Final Fantasy XI spin-offs like Rise of the Zillert, Chains of Promathia, Treasures of Atzurgan, and Wings of the Goddess. Lately, he's been working on like Final Fantasy XIV and Final Fantasy XIII 2, and Lightning Returns Final Fantasy XIII. The latest he's been working on is Arcadia no Aoki Miko, and that came out in 2015.
Interesting. So yeah, I haven't personally played this game, but it sounds like it's pretty cool. Kind of like a return. You might dig it, Todd.
Yeah, I haven't played it either, but listening to you talking about all of its inspiration, it sounds like it comes from all of my favorite games in the series. Dragon.
At least the soundtrack is cool. The soundtrack sounds like a real throwback. You know, you get some of those like NES and Game Boy tones coming through with the more kind of modern samples. You know, this has a very Japanese feel to it, which I think a lot of that Japanese console game flavor has been lost in the more recent Final Fantasies as well. Mm-hmm. So this is kind of a big throwback in both audio terms and in gameplay terms.
That's
true. For the series.
Yeah.
So, and Bravely Default was exactly the same way. You know, it really brought back, and I feel like this is kind of like maybe didn't sell very well, because I didn't even know about it until I started researching Fantasy games for this show. And so, and then Bravely Default got such accolades.
Yeah.
So, you know, maybe their decision to change the name and take it away from the Final Fantasy series kind of garnered a little bit more attention. So, you know, if this game had come out as the first Bravely Default or Bravely Default Zero, maybe it would have gotten a little more attention from people.
A little more hype.
Yeah. Square's been known to take games and slap the name Final Fantasy on it in order for it to sell. So I think a lot of people are jaded because of that. So
that's
maybe
true.
Maybe moving it away from the Final Fantasy franchise to Bravely Default made people more willing to give it a chance.
Absolutely.
Just like with the Game Boy games that we were talking about earlier. I mean, they slapped the Final Fantasy name on like Final Fantasy Legend and all those games, Final Fantasy The Adventure and all those. Those were Saga.
Got me to purchase them.
Yeah, they were Saga and Mama titles. So they were going after you, Todd.
And it worked.
It worked. But not for this one, though. Because later on, you said, was it like a falling out where you're like, after a certain point, you were like, meh, I'm good.
No, I actually have the game. I just haven't played it.
Oh, really? Okay.
it's one of those backlog games that, you know, you buy a game and you say, yeah, man, I'm going to play this. And you never get around to it.
I know that
something
feeling.
Something else comes out.
Yeah.
We all have them.
I fell off the wagon with Final Fantasy for after 10. I've heard 12 is really good. And I know
loved 12.
You had mentioned 12, and I was actually kind of looking forward to talking about 12 with you because
there's no tracks from 12.
Yeah,
I'm actually getting in to talk about it.
I know.
It's such a great game. I really like 12.
Do
a lot.
You really?
Just briefly talk about my love for 12. I really, really like it. It's got great graphics for the PS2.
Mm-hmm.
I really liked the story. I really liked the world. I spent more time just exploring the world than I did just playing the game.
Okay.
I really loved it. A lot of people don't like it,
mm-hmm.
partially because of the system that you can use to basically make the gameplay itself, and a lot of people didn't like that. But you don't have to use it. It's not being forced on you.
Right.
So you can have as much or as little interaction with the battles as you want, which is a nice way to customize how the game flows. I really liked it.
My biggest problem with 12, and again, going back to, I'm a very visual person when it comes to RPGs, I have to like the character design and the story and the gameplay itself. Everything else kind of falls into place. Like, I expect that the music is going to be high quality because it's Final Fantasy, and I'm often never wrong about that, or I'm often always right about that, rather. But with 12, I don't know, the characters all looked very bland in terms of the coloring of the characters, like the design and the coloring of the characters. Like, Fran looked really cool. She was like this weird like rabbit lady girl. Yeah, I don't know what it was about Final Fantasy XII. I think the palette, the color palette, everything looked really washed out. And I don't know if that was just because of the design that they were going with or whatever, but everything looked really, really washed out.
I can understand that.
Yeah.
I can understand it. I mean, there's places in the game where it's a lot more colorful, a lot more vibrant. But if you only saw maybe the first
few areas of the game,
character designs.
Yeah, or screenshots. Seen,
like much of the world itself.
There's I haven't seen it in motion. I'd like to see it in motion sometime.
It's on PS2. It's just so well done.
Right.
So well done. There's so
I'll have to pick it up. I'll have to check it out. All right. So moving on to our final track of the day. And this is my final pick. Love this game. Final Fantasy Dissidia Duodecim 012 or whatever you want to call it. 2011 was release date. Chaos Shrine is the name of the song. And this is actually an arrangement of a song from Final Fantasy 1. And the track was composed by, again, Takeharu Ishimoto. Welcome back. That was our final track of the day. Final Fantasy Dissidia. We're just going to call it Final Fantasy Dissidia 012 because I have no idea what a duodecim is. It sounds like a Dewey Decimal System.
Duodecim.
I have no idea what that is. Do you have any idea?
Square just makes up words.
I'm thinking
so. Or have
so.
You not figured this out by
yeah,
now?
I'm thinking that they're, as you said during the break, they're taking darts and just tossing them at a dartboard
oh, yeah.
for awkward
yeah.
names. They're
between
taking,
this and Kingdom Hearts, you're yeah. like, what are you talking about?
They're taking the Metal Gear naming system.
Well, Duodecim, I think, is like every 200 years or every...
Something like that.
Something like that.
I have no
it's
idea.
An actual word.
Oh, I'm sure it is. It's just, it's one of those, like, let's just pick a random word to attribute to the title. Anyways, came out in 2011, Chaos Shrine, which is an arrangement from a Final Fantasy 1 track. Definitely doesn't sound like anything from Final Fantasy 1 in terms of audio quality. The track was composed by Takaharu Ishimoto, who we talked about, who did Final Fantasy VII Crisis Core, and of course his love of heavy guitar really comes forward on this track.
Duodecim means 12.
12?
So it's 0-12, 12.
Okay. So it's like
problems
ATM
solved.
Machine?
Yes.
Or
pin number.
Or GUI interface?
Or Jeb Bush.
Jeb Bush?
Yeah, Jeb is an acronym for his name.
Really?
Yeah, it's like John E. Bush.
John E. Bush Bush?
Yeah.
I never knew that.
That's I don't know funny. If it's John, but his first name
right.
is not Jeb.
Right. Wow,
that's
funny. Silly. So, have you guys played this game?
Nope.
Really?
Never heard of it until today.
Oh, really? Interesting. Have you?
No.
No, really?
I've never played it, mainly because of the PSP.
But you said fighting games, so now I'm interested.
Yes. Okay, so let's talk about this game. So, it's a fighting game. It is the sequel to the original Dissidia fighting game, which, to me... Now, I don't know if you know this about me, but I'm a pretty big Tifa fan. Tifa Lockhart. So, first game came out with Dissidia, and I was, like, looking at the character release, and I'm like, where's Tifa? Where's Tifa? She's not in it. I don't want to play as Tifa. And it's a fighting game. That'd be awesome. Like Air Guys, you could play as Tifa. So I was like, I'll wait this one out. You know, I'll wait till it's bargain bin price. About, what, a year after the game came out, they pulled a Tecmo and a Capcom and released a new version of the game with more characters. And of course, Tifa was in there. So I was like, dude, sold. Really enjoyed it, actually. I played as a bunch of different characters, not just Tifa. They actually included a character from Final Fantasy XII, the main character, and also Lightning from Final Fantasy XIII. So the game is a fighting game. It's kind of like Super Smash Bros. A little bit in the sense that there's a lot of focus on platforming. Most of the platforms are very generic, like rocks and buildings and stuff like that, but everything crumbles. Like, you can destroy parts of the platforms and they crumble, then they eventually come back. But the combo system in the game fighting system is very unique. You launch characters, the whole point of it, like if you're playing the game, you'll get very confused very, very fast. So you kind of have to play around a bit. It's not just a punch, 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 kick, kick, kick sort of thing. It's more of like you launch characters up in the air and then you do these like devastating like attacks and they wipe out their like numbered bar. There's like a number at the bottom of the screen, and depending on what type of attack you do, it can really decimate the character. It can like basically knock them down, give them no energy, no stamina, and then they can't do any moves because they don't have enough of the numbers. It's really confusing, but when you actually sit down and play the game quite a bit, it gets really addictive and you get into it. The game is meant to play like an RPG in the sense that you always keep coming back to it and you kind of learn more about the characters in the game and everything. It's got a pretty cool story. The story is basically about the eternal fight between the gods of chaos and cosmos. And so basically what these two gods have done is they've requested, like summoned several different types of warriors from each side. So light side and dark side. You've got these characters who are very good, like Tifa and Cloud and Squall and all the heroes of the Final Fantasy universe. And then on the other side, you've got these very evil characters like Kefka and all these like evil, evil Sephiroth and all these evil characters who fight for the bad guys. So it's kind of like a light versus dark, good versus evil sort of thing. And they all kind of collide into this giant story. It's fun. It's really cool. It's also got these like boards that you can go to where it's like you go to these specific areas and then you get into the location. It's like almost like a board, almost like a board game where you have to advance to a certain spot and then you start fighting characters. If you win, you can go to another spot where there's a treasure chest. You get the treasure chest, and it's got a specific item that you can use in the game later on. So it's cool. It's definitely worth checking out. I would probably pick up the sequel, not just because it has Tifa in it, but because there's more characters. There's, I'm pretty sure it's almost the same story, but it's like, it's more advanced. Everything is basically enhanced in this game when compared with the first one. So you're getting a better game with this one.
Cool.
So, yeah, I recommend checking it out if you're at all interested in playing games like this. If you're into fighting games, I would say I had more fun with this than other like attempts at bringing fighting to the Final Fantasy world, like Air Guys. Air Guys is cool, but I had way more fun with this. For the track, it's epic. Awesome, awesome double bass, heavy metal. This is my idea of really awesome metal. You've got double bass, you've got, you know, really heavy guitar. That first opening riff, just with the guitar licks, really good stuff. So I dug it. And it has like symphonic sprinkles throughout the track, which kind of highlight, make the track sound a little bit more vibrant. So
yeah, the same guy that did the Soldier Battle song, but I like that style a lot more than this style.
Yeah, this is a little bit more heavier. And
yeah, definitely and, more you than me.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Less Soundgarden, more, I don't know, Symphony X,
yes.
I guess you could say.
Yes.
Yeah. What about you, Todd?
I think you've pretty much said it all. I mean, yeah. I haven't played the game, and I'm not familiar with the soundtrack, so this is really my first exposure to it.
It is multiplayer, so if you guys pick it up, let me know, because we could sit down and play it. It's pretty cool. I haven't played it multiplayer, but from the single player, from what I learned about the game, the single player, it's one of those types of games where you play it single player on your own, and then if you happen to meet up with people who also have it, you could be like, oh cool, let's play online or whatever, or let's play multiplayer. So right. It's cool.
Cool. Well, that about wraps up our show for the day.
It's true.
Doesn't mean there won't be any more Final Fantasy songs in the future.
True.
Though, or Final Fantasy episodes. We might do something a little more focused on one particular game or one particular soundtrack.
That'd be fun.
Or one particular composer.
Yeah.
Let us know what you guys think. We are always available to talk and chat at facebook.com/groups/pixeltunesradio. Give us a tweet at pixeltunesradio on Twitter. You can even email us at pixeltunesradio@gmail.com.
That's true. You could also watch us on youtube.com/dongled, and that's where you can check out Pixel Tunes Radio in its video format. And if you're more of an audio person or you want to listen to this just the audio, you can listen to us at iTunes. And yeah. I was going to say something additional, but I was just like, nah, I'm good.
Cool.
I'm going to back off.
Yeah. Todd, where can we find you on the web?
I am nowhere on the web.
He is a ghost.
Doesn't even have a Facebook account.
Wow.
But
we do appreciate Todd coming in and talking about Final Fantasy with us.
Thanks for having me on again, guys.
Absolutely.
Always a pleasure.
So we got a lot of stuff coming up in the future.
We do.
We have like up until mid-March planned out for Pixel Tunes Radio. So
pretty
we've
crazy.
We've got a show full of friends and their picks. We've got a show based on it's a one game focus,
yes,
show with some amazing soundtracks,
mm-hmm,
and then we've got an extra special plan with a sister podcast, a sister VGM podcast coming up, in which we're going to review a series of game soundtracks. That's,
yes,
going to be a lot of fun as well.
We don't want to spoil too much.
We are kicking off 2016 with a bang.
Not an oomph.
No, with a bang.
With a bang.
An oomph.
2015 bang was the year of the oomph. 2016 is going to be the year of the bang. And 2017 is the year of the carrot.
Oomph bang carrot?
Yeah.
Is there just some sort of reference here I'm not getting?
Nah.
Okay.
I just like carrots.
Radical.
Yeah, man.
All right. Well, in case you guys haven't heard it, we just recently released a mixtape of episode 53. So episode 53 was our Sweatin' with the Indies episode, and a couple of listeners requested that we kind of trim the fat, if you will.
Take so out we're a lot the of fat. The,
yes, exactly.
We are the fat.
We are the fat.
Yes.
Fat be gone.
Yeah. yes.
To basically create like a half hour long mixtape of just mostly the music from the episode with just little intermissions of us introducing the songs in between each one. So if you're, you know, on the treadmill or running on a track or just lifting some weights or whatever, you want to listen to a whole bunch of really good energetic music.
Or if you don't want to, or if you don't want to listen to us, you forgot that.
Or
one.
That, you, yeah, know, if you just get really tired of us prattling on, you can just listen to the music that we've chosen for our show. It's not going to be in every show thing.
Right. This is more just specifically. Edition. Right.
Yeah, so you can go check that out over on iTunes or on pixeltunesradio.com as well.
Word.
That's all I got for today. All
right, I'm going to go hang out with my Tifa Lockhart body pillow and wash my hair with my Tifa Lockhart shampoo and, you know, maybe eat some Tifa Lockhart candy.
I'm going to go try to finish up Undertale.
Yeah?
Yeah. Still cool. Haven't beat it yet.
Yeah.
Going to do it eventually.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Cool. What about you, Toad? What do you got planned?
I have housework to do.
Really?
Bummer.
Lame.
Dude. Do you want to borrow my body pillow?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Can I?
Yeah, sure.
Is it clean?
That's all the show we have for today. Pixel Tunes Radio signing off.
See you in 2 weeks, boys and girls.